Thanks.
It's a little surreal when they start rattling off the things you've done in your life because you start having flashbacks all of a sudden. So, but thank you. Thank you, sir, for that. I want to thank God first and foremost for giving me the life I've had, for giving me the life I'm currently living, and for giving me an opportunity to speak to this group. I want to thank God for the Catholic religion, for the Catholic Church. I want to thank some of the men in here who I got to know fairly well on a Christ Renews His Parish weekend, both as retreatants and as team members. Oh, Brady's over there. James is over there. Brian's not here. Michael's here. Let's see, who else am I missing? It's not a bad group. And it was truly an honor to be able to go on retreat and to deliver a retreat for other men with those young men. It was fabulous for me. And John Oberg's not here, but I can tell you, if you guys spend any time with John, he's a hard-charging CEO, executive-type guy with a big heart, and I really loved organizing everything. So much to be thankful for. So, I'm going to start with a reading. It's kind of my compass reading. It's from 1 Kings 19. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind tore the mountains and broke in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a low whisper. And when Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his cloak and went out and stood at the entrance to the cave. And behold, there came a voice to him and said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" "What am I doing here? What are you doing here?" I've personally heard that voice, and I heard that whisper. So, as Sarah said, my name is Steve Potter. Kind of a simple update in terms of who I am. Kind of my favorite part is I'll get to the work part and I'll get to what I did to evangelize in the workplace, but first and foremost, I'll say what I'm most proud of is the fact that I've been married for 36 years.
Woo! Yeah.
So I have a lifetime partner, which is absolutely amazing. I have three children. Those three children, I have two grandchildren now. And basically, I have a wonderful, functional family that still loves to get together. And I consider that one of the greatest sources, probably the chief item on my resume that I'm most proud of. And I really can't take much credit for that. I'm just really thrilled that I could be a part of that. So we'll talk about the work thing a little bit. My work bio, it was quite a few stops along the way. I started as a management trainee. When I met my wife as a teacher, she was making more money than me. I worked for a savings and loan in Austin, which was great. You were a young person, you're in Austin. Now that was in the early 80s. It was awesome back then too. And it still is now. And so I went from First Texas, I became a branch manager with them, had a great job, you know, all was going well, but I got bored. Needed more money. So I left. I went to go work for, what was IDS at the time? It became Ameriprise, Financial Planning Group. So I was going to sell mutual funds, annuities, all that wonderful stuff. Well, I left there. And I started to look for work, and I actually ended up working for Interfirst Bank Austin. So I got back into banking, decided that was where I wanted to be. But then I got bored again. So I went to go work for Barnett Banks in Florida. That was a great job, loved it. They became Bank of America after they were acquired. Didn't love it so much anymore. And then I had the chance to come back to Texas, and I did. I went to go work for USAA. I don't know if you're familiar with them, but they're a stellar company. Incredible management, incredible product set, incredible customer service, and it was an amazing 10 years that I had. It was a great 10-year run there. That ended, and then I went to MasterCard, of which that basically was the last stop on my career so far. So I haven't been retired more than a few months, so I don't know if I'm retired yet, but I'm learning how to be retired, and I'm still not sure exactly what that means. So we will get there. My spiritual bio. So I basically was not born Catholic. I didn't become Catholic until I was 39. I was one of those folks that I grew up Methodist and went to a Baptist university, Baylor University. And quite frankly, I was a little frightened of the Catholics because of all their rules and everything else that they had with us. I was like, what is all this stuff? Right? So where do you get this from? So I was 39 when I became Catholic, which is all fine and well because I eventually got there, as I guess we all do. So, but I will tell you that my spiritual journey really began in fourth grade. I went to public school, and this will date me. They actually passed out small little New Testaments in public school. I was in fourth grade. And I got this New Testament, and I started reading that. And I went to church with the family. You know, we were going to Methodist church, I was Boy Scouts, you know, that kind of stuff. But it never really meant anything until I started reading that little New Testament. I was like, wow. It just resonated with me. So I went into my family's library there, and I found the family Bible. Nobody else was reading it. And so basically I picked it up and I started reading this Bible, and I loved it. I started reading cover to cover. I didn't make it all the way through the Old Testament. I mean, that's super, it got really, really hard. But the Gospels I read over and over and over. And that Bible went with me my entire life. Especially in college, where you run into all kinds of stuff when you're going through college. And so in my whole life, I've had one major speed bump. It happened when I was younger, and it was one of those things that happened after a special moment when I talked about Elijah and that whisper. About a month before this event happened, I was in my front yard. We were actually working in the yard. And what's interesting is my big moments in life, they haven't happened in a church, but they have happened. So I'm in the yard, and all of a sudden, everything just made sense. It was like there was no me, there was no yard. It was like everything was perfect. It was like I was touched, and I can still remember it to this day. That just tells you how different it was. And so I just made an assumption that was a God moment for me. And about a month later, it was in our house, and my mom was watching TV, and she got up from it, and my brother and I were in another room, and she came walking in, and all of a sudden, her eyes rolled up, she fell on the floor, and she didn't move. And my brother and I panicked, went and got my dad, right? You always go get your dad. It was Saturday. Because your dad solves everything. Well, Dad didn't know what to do other than call 911. I knew mouth to mouth. I knew how to get mouth to mouth. I was going to go to med school. That was my plan. So I had to get mouth to mouth for my mom. It was a horrible, horrible experience. She passed. She was gone. And that was truly a life-changing moment for me. I was so thankful I had found that Bible ahead of time, because I basically decided to try things that were different than what I was doing. I was Eagle Scout up to that moment, and then it was like, well, maybe life's a little too short, I better start changing things up a little bit. So I did. I started changing things up, and you know, sometimes you don't change them up for the better, but I had a good time. Some of those times I did learn some things, but I never drifted too far away. My spiritual journey, I have always been grounded, somehow grounded, whether I was going to church, whether I was getting advice from somebody else, and I continue to remain somehow centered. Now, I'm not, Michael brought this up earlier, I'm not a super Catholic, right? I've got really good friends that are super Catholics. There's a spectrum of your Catholicism. How well you know the religion. I mean, seriously, how well you know all the rules and how good you are at following those. And I have friends that are so amazing in terms of doing that. I'm not one of those. I'm a spiritual teen guy, but I'm not going to pick a teen that says Catholic is better than Methodist is better than Baptist is better than. I can't do that because I really do think that God is in every single one of us and a part of us, and that our main job is to look for God, not just in ourselves, get out of the way and let God be that, but in other people. And that gets to the greatest two commandments. Love God, and love your neighbor. And that gets us into the workplace. So, I'm going to give you a couple things in terms of workplace advice, and then we'll get into what I did spiritually when I was in the workplace. So, I can tell you, work hard, do all that, you know, and I could count all kinds of stuff in terms of how I did. And, you know, whether that was, you know, getting up at 5 a.m. on the weekends and studying stuff and being there longer at the office and just applying yourself and figuring out what you need to do better and different. But I'm going to give you a couple other things that I really think made a huge difference for me. And it may or may not work for you, but I work for some pretty big companies, and somehow I made it work. So, first thing I'm going to tell you is leave. All right? But one of the number one things that employees would come up to me, they would come up and say, I am so frustrated. A lot of where I ended up by that leave factor. But I left when my heart told me to. Right? It was one of those things where it wasn't irrational, it wasn't emotional, it was a risk, but I took it. Because I wasn't going to be the one whining about why I wasn't getting promoted or that Sarah was getting promoted or, you know, somebody else was getting. I wasn't going to do that. So I'm going to tell you, leave if it's that bad. And then I'm going to tell you another thing. Be underpaid for a while. Be underpaid. Right? It happens. Sometimes you're in a job. And you're good at it, right? You know you're good at it. Other people would know you're good at it. And so you're going to be underpaid for a while. They're not going to recognize how wonderful you are right away. This is not how it works. So be underpaid. And that's okay. Don't be underpaid forever, right? I mean, you're that good, right? And they're not going to recognize it. Somebody else will. And that's how it works, all right? And then I'm going to tell you to be underskilled. It's the other end of the spectrum. Every promotion I ever got, I was like, how am I ever going to do this? I don't know how to do that stuff. And I'm like, they don't know that I don't know, or maybe they do, but it doesn't really matter. And so you just jump in, right? You're like, okay, God, I can do this, right? You really don't know you can do it. You just do it, right? And that's the other side of that. Don't be afraid of it. Don't overanalyze it. You just do it. So those are the things, right? Leave, be underpaid, right? Be underskilled. And then I'll give you the three things that I think are the death knell when you're making a decision. Money. Don't make a decision just to go for the money. I have a little story about that. I'll show that in just a minute. But I have found that that's not a good reason to leave. Title. Do not make a decision to leave for title. Title is really almost irrelevant at the end of the day. What is relevant are the skills you're picking up and how they show on your resume or LinkedIn or whatever else you're going to do and how they enhance the resume. That is what really matters. And then, last but not least, and this actually gets into the capital part, do not try and figure out how to make it fair. People go, well, it's unfair, right? So-and-so got promoted. That's unfair. I'm not getting recognized. That's unfair. Fairness will drive you crazy. You will spend your time on that, and you won't spend it on honing your skills, getting better at what you're doing, and controlling what you can control. And I say this from personal experience and from teams that I've managed before. So do not get into the fairness trap. It's a little like the envy deal. Your path is your path and their path is theirs, and it's not your job to worry about theirs. So, that's the workplace bio. Now the workplace spiritual bio. So I'm I'm not an aggressive evangelist. Actually, I don't know if I've ever met a Catholic who is. When I went to Baylor, there was some aggressive evangelism, right? I mean, that truly was. But in Catholicism, it fits more of my personality. That's not my personality because my greatest fear is steering someone away. So what I typically would do, and this is so easy to do, you guys. These are so easy to put into practice. Call it Sunday Fun Day. You go into the office, and it's Monday or Tuesday. Usually, directionally, you want to be Monday or Tuesday after the weekend, or Thursday or Friday before the weekend. And you just start talking to people. Go, hey, what did you do last weekend? And most of the time, they'll rattle off a few things, and they'll ask you, hey, what did you do last weekend? Well, Sunday, we started going to church. And what's incredible in the office is how many people don't go to church. And it is the perfect opportunity to be able to highlight that from a weekend standpoint. And, oh, Tim said it earlier, people will ask questions. When they're in the right spot, you have just planted a seed, and they're like, well, where'd you go to church? Well, what was the homily like? Well, that was Father Bud running around back then, so, you know, 8 out of 10 homilies weren't that great. But you did the best you could. Come up with whatever the message was, right? whatever you could try and work with. So the Sunday fun day deal is so easy to do. And then prior to the next week, it's like, what are you going to do this weekend? You know, oh, we're Super Bowl, blah, blah, blah. You know, it's like, well, we're going to church on Sunday. And I don't know if you pre-read something or can throw something else in there. But then once again, they're like, where do you go to church? And what kind of church? What are you? You know, let them ask these questions because it doesn't take long before everybody in the office knows, oh, Steve, he goes to church. It makes him kind of unique, right? And you'd actually be shocked at what that does. It doesn't make you like a priest, but people come up to you. Seriously. I mean, it's kind of scary, but and a lot of responsibility, but it's a wonderful thing. Right? Because very few people ever bring it up in the office. And so it's such a simple way to be able to do that. Okay, the next one I'll call it Sunday Fun Day. This is couples therapy. And for my wife and I, 36 years, we have not always been wonderful in terms of our church life. It's kind of cyclical. And I will admit it. But we both know that the times we have been the tightest, the times we have been, our relationship has been the strongest, is when we're both going to church, when we're both spiritually active. It never fails. And you almost have to kind of go through these little droughts to see that. And so when I'm talking to people, and all of a sudden they're saying, well, you know, she just doesn't understand it. He just doesn't understand it. Wow, I mean, there's 101 reasons why relationships start to get a little, and you guys either are not married, barely married, hoping to get married. So I'm just telling you, that when you're married, it ain't all a straight path. Do not believe it for a second. And if somebody tells you, they're lying, because it just doesn't work like that. But the way it does work is you've got your good moments and you've got your not so good moments. And those good moments for us were always when we were going to church. So always ask them, so you guys going to church? Yeah. So what are you leaning on? How are you working through this? You're just doing it by yourselves? What are you doing? And then I say, my wife and I have always strengthened our relationship by going to church. It's just how we've done it. And I'm not sure I understand why. I just know it works. So if it works for us, it can work for you. And when we're married, you know, 5 years, that had a certain level of credibility, but then you get married 20 years, 25 years, 30 years, 35 years, all of a sudden, there's real credibility when you start saying that. And people, you know this, people love to talk about their relationships. That's what you do. If it's not going well, it's obvious. All you have to do is ask certain people. You just ask them. So how are you doing? How are you and your spouse doing? Right? Now you need to know they have a spouse. You need to understand that. And that gets to my third one, right? So we've got Sunday fun day, we've got a couple therapy. You gotta listen. You got to listen. I love to listen. Because that, it's in a way, it's almost a curse for me, because I can forget almost any fact I need for work, but I can remember your personal history. Brady and I were just talking, and I can tell you everything that he was just sharing in terms of what he's going to be doing. And it's amazing. And I am so excited for him. And I'll tell you what, that's how it is at the office. Now, I talked to my brother. He goes to his office. I say, so are they married? Do they have any? He goes, I don't know. Who cares? I'm like, this is a problem. Listen, because that's what you do when you love. You listen. You understand. You hear what they're telling you. These are not complicated, y'all. Seriously. You guys can do this, right? I know you can do this. And so I would encourage you to figure out how to hone your listening skills. Okay. So you got the three things I did at the office. You guys can practice all these. I know you can make that happen. The other part of the listening, which I found interesting, and I didn't know I was really doing it at the time, is years later, employees would come up to me, even random people that didn't even work for me, that they just worked for the company. They would thank me invariably for listening. And I'd be like, well, did we solve anything? It didn't matter. I listened. And that helped him get through whatever it was he was trying to get through at the moment. And it didn't take anything on my part except real love for them. So I would encourage you to do that. Now, I'm supposed to come up with a couple of challenges for y'all. And so I'm going to do that. But before I do that, I got one other thing. Just one other story. Alright. So okay. So I told you I went to go work for, I left the savings alone, I was a branch manager, went to go work for this financial planning company. All great, well. You know, I get married at the time, we're married about 2 months. My wife comes home from teaching that day, and I'm sitting on the back porch after I've been there 6 months. I said, I quit my job. She said, what? I said, yeah, I quit my job. I was uncomfortable with how I was having to sell. I was comfortable with the money, but I was uncomfortable with the recommendations I was making. So I was being trained in a way that I was just not comfortable. And I quit my job. Well, I couldn't find one right away. So I don't know if you guys have ever heard of Manpower, but I worked for them all throughout college and sometimes in high school. And it's like a temp agency. You do hourly stuff. And it's basically whatever needs to be done. Warehouse, outdoor stuff, construction, whatever. And so I had a degree in finance from Baylor University, and I'm not digging ditches. I am ditches. Talk about humbling. And so years later, and I mean a lot of years later, like recently, and this was the start of my career. My dad tells me, you know, the moment I was most proud of you, and I'm like, I made SP, this. No. When you lost that job and you were digging ditches. He said, yeah, I knew you were going to be just fine. And it took me aback. I really had to think what he was talking about. And basically, I'm still not sure I know exactly what he was talking about, other than I was humbled, sucked it up, just did what needed to be done, and moved forward. And so you're going to find yourself in situations at work that are going to feel a little like that. You're just going to have to do just kind of what I was doing. And if someone's looking down, like a parent, because you never know they're really watching, right? They're going to go, good for you. Good for you. So I want to share that because while the success stuff is fun to talk about, the stuff that's maybe less successful, maybe actually was more successful in building character than the wins themselves. So, challenge for y'all. Pick a partner wisely and prayerfully. I'm going to tell you this. I knew when I was young, my vision was I was going to have a family and I was going to have three kids. That's what I was going to do. And that was my main goal in life, right? And so I knew when I was going to pick a partner, well, you had to have a wife to do that, but I knew that, that was what I was going to do. Now, your partner could be your career. Your partner could be whatever gift you have to give to the world. You don't have to get married. You don't have to have kids. That was mine, right? That's what I saw. And that's what I did. And so, when I basically was looking for a wife, I actually started looking in college. And I had two criteria. So once again, it's back to looking for a wife. Now, you may not be looking for a spouse, you may be looking for something else, but all I can describe is what I did. So I looked for two things. I looked for somebody that I wanted to be with when I was old, right? Because when you're young, almost everybody's fun to be with, right? I mean, that's just how it works. Right? But you're able to last, trust me. And then you get to be this age and you still better be having fun or you're really going to be miserable. So you look for somebody that you can be old with. And for me, I want to find somebody that would be a terrific mom. A terrific mom. And so, because I knew I wanted to have kids. And I knew that was going to be a weakness for me. Right? But it still is. I love my kids to death, but can't love them nearly as much as my wife does. She's amazing. She's amazing. And so, with that as a criteria, I went all through college, dated every 3 months, 6 months, you know, it didn't take long, it was almost a little like interview. And so you went through the process, and you're like, no, you're not hiring me, you're not hiring me. I had a couple fired me too, so it wasn't just all my fault. And so I finally get out of college, and I get my first job, and I'm here in Austin, and I'm in an apartment over off Foster Lane, you know, near Anderson Lane, and so I'm walking up one day, and a new neighbor's moving in. And I look at her, and I'm like, whoa. This was August. So, and how convenient. Just my neighbor. This is great. And so sure enough, she moves in, and we start dating, and we get engaged. New Year's Eve, and we get married in April, and that was 36 years ago, because I just knew, right? I just knew. It was like one of those things where if you really know what you want, if you're really true to yourself, if you're really spiritually centered, you just know, right? And yes, things can happen that you can't control, and you know, people can get sick or have other things, but y'all, for the most part, if you take your job seriously and center yourself, you can do a good job of finding that partner, whatever that is. And that could also be work and career. Not everybody has to be married and have kids. That's not the way the world works. Nor would I encourage you. Okay, so answer the question. What are you doing? And so I'm going to ask you, what are you doing? What are you doing here? I'm asking myself that. I just retired. What am I doing here? Well, let me tell you, when I left, let's see, USA, I was 50. I was semi-involved in church. I became really involved. I basically had a second chapter. I had a sabbatical before I went with MasterCard. So, found a great church, loved it. So what did we do? Start teaching confirmation. I'm teaching teenagers. God, I kicked them out of the house. I got to teach them again. It was awesome. We did confirmation for 5 years. I went on more than a dozen Acts retreats, and that includes with our teens. So we did that. I was capital campaign, in charge of our capital campaigns for building. I was on the capital the Community Foundation, worked with the Archbishop in San Antonio. Let's see, I was chairman of the board of San Antonio Education Partnership. There were half a dozen organizations that I joined. And it's because I knew I had something to give. I just wasn't sure exactly where to give it, so I joined. You guys are here tonight. Fabulous. It's a great start. You may have joined a half dozen other things. I'm just telling you. What are you doing here needs to be, what are you doing here? And that's a question God's going to ask, and that's a question you should be asking yourself all the time. Okay. I'm studying a lot. I don't know if you guys read much, but I've got a whole list of, well, USCCB every day comes to me, right? I don't know if you guys get tagged, but I learned some of these through church. We actually got some of them through our church process. Let's see. I actually take a Buddhist magazine too, twice. So I'm all about trying to understand what the world's going on in the world today. Daily Good, Bishop Robert Barron, good stuff. Great way to interpret it. Brain Pickings, On Being, Parabola, Spirituality in Practice. There is so much material out there. When you guys have some downtime, fill it with some of that. It will absolutely give you something to chew and work on. Absolutely. And so I encourage you to do it. It will make you stronger. It will keep you stronger. It will keep you thinking in the right direction. And it will make you stronger at work, which is where you need to be strong, because people need that. People aren't doing this. This is not what people do. They do what typically you see. They basically watch TV, they do the fun stuff, they talk about the fun stuff, but at the end of the day, they're going to need your help. And if you're there and you're with them, that is the most important moment in your life. So be smart in terms of how you approach it. And then the last thing, build and keep a thankful list. I told you I lost my mom when I was 16, and so it's real easy for me to build a list from that. She never got to watch us graduate from high school, graduate from college, start dating, get married, have children, have grandchildren. I've done all these things. What more do I need? Oh my gosh. My life is so full. Even on my worst day, that list is so full. And I guarantee each and every one of you has a list like that. And that list will just get longer as long as you recognize what you need to be thankful for, which is pretty much everything. Which is pretty much everything. And so I'm incredibly thankful that I came to St. John Newton, that I became a member, that I went through church right away. And whether it's Christ in His Parish or Acts or Discover or whatever we end up calling it at some point, if you haven't been on a retreat, go on a retreat. There is no better way for you to know yourself, for you to know others, and for you to be strong with the Lord. There is no better way that I've found. And maybe it's just my personality, maybe it's a sweet spot for me, but I've got friends for life, and because of it, I'm here now. And I'm thankful that you allowed me to be here. This is a very... My son came up last weekend and we went fly fishing. Went down to Guadalupe. I don't know if you guys do any fly fishing. But he drove up from Houston and we spent a lot of time together and it was great. And we did some of the discussion that I just shared with you, right? And it's one of those where I'm trying to figure out what do I want to share with young people? Well, he's 27, turning 28. And he and I were talking about it, and right now I've got his resume because we had to talk in terms of, so is this your partner company for life? Do you know what you're doing? Yeah, I've been doing it for a while, they made changes. Yeah, they promised some things that are good. I said, well, sounds like 2018 is a big year. A big year. What are you doing about that? Right? And so, if you can't get it and make them recognize it where you're at, then make it happen elsewhere. And so, y'all, you're in charge of your destinies. Right? Don't wait. you know, right? So when it's basically, instead of Elijah, when it's you guys, and say, what are you doing here? You guys need to hear this. I know what I'm doing here. I'm loving life and appreciate every single one of y'all. And especially love the brothers that I went through the church process with. And I'm thankful that young people like yourselves are willing to come out after a hard day and a long day of work and listen to somebody like me and to basically do what you're doing, to affirm your Catholic faith, and that's it.
Any other questions? Yes, question. You mentioned that you became Catholic at 39.
Yeah.
And I'd be interested in hearing, you know, what the impetus behind that was. And even more, I'd be interested in hearing, I would assume that your family was well established at that point.
It was.
And how you, you know, whether that's a personal step that you bring your family along with, but, you know, just kind of what impact that had on, you know, everybody in this
group.
It doesn't really have a family, but if that sort of thing comes.
Yeah, great question. So yes, we had three kids at the time. We were living in Jacksonville, Florida, and the school system there. So we were actually going to Catholic church. So my wife was Catholic, and my three kids were being raised Catholic. I was the hanger-on non-Catholic, right? Still going to church, but I like the church. I like the community. So we actually sent them to Catholic church there. Involved. I was working on the weekends, and you know, and I went to my first fish fry, right? I went to Baylor, you guys. It's Baptist, for crying out loud. I went to my first Catholic fish fry. It's in a gymnasium like this, and they've got cakes of beer. I was like, this is crazy. Seriously, all of a sudden, the whole thing was changing for me. I'm like, So like anything else, right, I came to know it, right? You're always fearful of what you don't know, right? You hear snippets, you hear stuff, right, and you're fearful of it. And that's just the way the world works, right, because you don't know it. And we all have a tendency to do that, right? We hold on, we segment ourselves, we put ourselves in this little segment, and we really don't know how it works, but we're more than happy to comment on it, right? And I was more than happy to comment on Catholicism, but I didn't really know anything about it. Right? I just knew what I read in certain places and certain headline stuff. And so, yes, my family brought me along. I was there and I said, I'm going to do this. This is a church. It's God-oriented. And I don't really understand how it works. And I want to be a part of my family. Right? Have us all be Catholic. And I loved RCIA. I loved the teaching. I was smarter than almost all the Catholics there because I studied everything. And they didn't have a clue. And I'd go and say, well, why gave you this? And I'd say, my wife, well, you know, here's why we're doing this. And she goes, I didn't know that. And I'm like, well, neither is any other Catholic I talked to. So it was actually a wonderful experience. And I have a good friend that teaches RCIA down in our church in San Antonio. And he actually recommends that some of his Catholic friends that have been cradle Catholics go through it as well, because it really is fascinating. So it's a stunning, stunning religion, and it's stunning in terms of how it's carried forward for so long, right? And I won't get into all the rules and administration and all the other stuff that's involved in it. It is beautiful, though, in terms of the traditions, the liturgy. And we can travel the whole globe in half. And I can tell you, I've been to Mass in Italy multiple times, in Paris, Spain, and I love it. I love going to Mass when I'm there. Because you may not know the language, but you know where you are, Mass. And it feels so cool, right? Because we're all doing that together. So, yes, no, great question. Thank you for that question. Yes?
So, I'm a fellow convert, but I was interested in your, like, the best habits you have in a mostly secular workplace. If you're, like, the only Christian that loves.
Well, so there.
What's the question?
So basically, you're in a secular environment, and how are they going to know?
No, the best habits. The best habits.
Still
in the faith appropriately in such an environment.
Okay. Well, okay. So no, that's actually very clear. So what tends to happen in those environments is you tend to co-opt your soul and do what the company culture might be doing at that particular point in time. You can't do that if you truly are Catholic and you're spiritually centered. You never do that. So at times, you're a little like Jesus. You may not be well-respected within your organization because you're standing firm with what you know. Because the cultures in companies and organizations, it goes like this. And it's up to you to figure out how you're going to make your statement, right? And so for me, I didn't change. I didn't wait. People knew. I wasn't going to throw anybody under the bus. I wasn't going to chuck my ethics out the door. I didn't do any of that. Although I think it might help me career-wise had I done it at certain points in time. I didn't do it. And the other thing, when I spent that time listening to people, finding out about their lives, not just what they're doing at the office, but about their lives, that was taking time away from me managing upwards, doing some of the career stuff I could have been doing. It's a lot of work, right? To really get to know people at the office, and then to really be able to work with them and lift them up, and basically help lift the entire office up. That was one of the reasons that I left USA. I got to the point where the CEO, where I couldn't execute, I couldn't lift anybody up. If anything, I was a danger to people around me. And so what I did, I left. I said, this isn't going to work. If I can't go into the office and I can't, A, get my job done, and B, help everybody that I'm with, if I'm hurtful, then I'm gone. I'm out of here. Let somebody else do it. I need to find an environment where I can get back and do that again. I thought I might earn a retirement. I really did. I missed that whole being there. And I'm telling you start doing that, you start listening, you start knowing everybody, you start coming up with follow-up questions in terms of, well, how's this going? How's that going? I mean, it's as simple as, it could be their child, or it could be a family member, and they've got a health thing going on, or they've got, some tests they're studying for, and you bring that back up again, and all of a sudden, they're just like, you really care. How do you do that? This is work, right? Does anybody really care at work? Yeah, you do. You can start doing that tomorrow. Okay, anything else?